Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for the new screensavers is provided by Cachefly at cachefly.com. The new screensavers is brought to you by audible.com. To download the free audiobook of your choice, go to audible.com/NSS. And by Wealthfront. Wealthfront is a low-cost automated investment service and the most sophisticated way to invest your money. Whether you've got millions or you're just starting out, visit wealthfront.com/NSS and sign up to get your free personalized investment portfolio. That's wealthfront.com/NSS.
How to map them all in Pokémon GO, a tuition-free school for coders, and Leo gets his Tesla Model X. Live from the Twit Studios in beautiful downtown Petaluma, it's the new Screensavers.
He's a ginger Mancunian. That is not another kind of Pokemon. That is, there he is. He lives in Boston now, originally from Manchester, the UK. Nice job. Well done, Marcus. Thank you for joining us. Hey, it's Megan Morrone.
It is.
How are you? Good
I'm
to see you.
I'm doing well, Leo.
This is episode 63, July 23rd, 2016, of the new Screensavers. And I love it when people from the original Screensavers can be on the show with me. It makes me feel old. But you don't look a day over.
Oh, that's
you
so
look,
sweet.
You look great.
It, well, just, it makes me feel young again.
Yeah, we've been through a lot together since the original. When did you start on the original
Screensavers? 2000, I believe.
16 years ago.
Yeah, a short 16 years
And what
ago.
Was your job? Were you working on the web?
Yeah, I was a web producer. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, we got the Hollywood producer came in and said, let's mix it up. We need some girls.
By the way, that's Paul Block. Yeah. And he hates it when we call him the Hollywood producer.
Yeah,
but he was.
But he was.
So there you go.
Yeah.
And you started being on set. You started doing tips, and the rest is history.
The rest is history. Took some time off. Worked with you in the cottage a little bit.
The Jumping Monkeys show, which still to this day people go, I love Jumping Monkeys. Aww. I was listening to that great I'm a Twit song. Remember that Jeff did?
Yes.
And you're in it. You know, jumping. I'm another jumping monkey. And I thought, oh. So that was a parenting show, but. You know, weirdly enough, you took time off to parent.
Yeah.
Better probably to parent than actually to do a show about parenting, you know. I mean, because you'd had twins and you had three kids. Then, and you were working for Microsoft out of your house. And then I begged every time I saw you, I'd say, please come. And finally, we won you over, host of iOS Today and Tech News Today every Monday through Friday with Jason Howell. And always a pleasure to have you on.
Well, thank you.
All of our shows. We have a big show today. You're playing Pokemon Go, I noticed.
I am on level 3. So I'm not won over yet.
What? Yeah, but you probably have to play because your kids are playing. Is that why?
I'm not even convinced it's a good idea for them because, you know, they are the kind of kids that have so little impulse control that, like, if they're looking for a Pokemon and there's a car, you know, I'm just...
And that's the risk, and people brought that up, that people are... But, you know, given how many, I don't know how many playing, maybe 100 million people in the United States, all over the world now, launched in Japan yesterday, there have been... surprisingly few incidents. I mean, you hear of people walking off cliffs and walking into traffic, running into police cars. Okay, first of all, if you're playing Pokemon Go while driving, that's clearly a bad idea. But I agree with you, the kids might have temptation to kind of, oh, there's... But you'll, as you'll see as you play it, you don't really... You don't have to go chase it.
Right.
And they did take out the one feature that I think was causing trouble. They used to have a radar feature where people would see how close a Pokemon was... one, two, or three paw prints away, and then would go track it down. And I think that was the one that was getting people into trouble, walking off cliffs, going into private property. You don't, there's no reason to do that otherwise. And they, the folks at Pokemon, at Niantic who do Pokemon Go say, oh, it's a bug, but everything's three paw prints now. And there's no way to kind of track down a Pokemon Go. I don't think it's a bug. I think they realized that was getting people into trouble, and they just turned off that.
Well, on Tech News Today this week, I talked to Russell Hawley and Georgia Dow, both parents, both serious gamers. They've been playing with their kids.
Yeah, what
and
did they
we,
say?
You know, that with moderation, everything with moderation, they say. You can see that segment's up on our website and our Twitbits.
Yeah.
Or just
I think it's a great
Google
game.
It.
It's gotten our kid, Michael, walking. He used to say, you know, we used to have to drag him and force him to walk home from school. We don't live that far away. He's kicking and screaming the whole way. Now he begs. He says, no, I don't want to ride. He walks to and from a lot. He's walked, and I'm just looking. I have walked, playing myself, 50 kilometers. That's roughly 30 miles since it came out on July 6th. So I think it's good for you. And we go out, you see people, you go down to the parks over here, and there's everybody out there. Anyway, we're not going to talk about Pokemon Go today.
Yes, we are.
Okay, never mind, we are. But we're going to talk about it with an interesting angle, because we're talking about with two engineers, one who has knowledge of how network stacks work. He's Laurie Voss is the COO at NPM, the Node Package Manager, which is really a great network product. He's going to talk about why servers are so hard, why it's so hard to keep servers up when you have an onslaught of people, what the issues might be. We'll also talk, and this is going to be a lot of fun, to somebody who's developed that map. Have you seen the map? It's a global map of where Pokemon are. Michael Christopher helped create that map with a bunch of other people on Reddit and elsewhere. He actually reverse engineered, there it is, you can see there's Pokemon all over the place. He reverse engineered the server's API. So we're going to talk about kind of under the hood Pokemon Go a little bit later on today. We'll also talk about something you may be interested in, a tuition-free school for programmers, for code engineers in Silicon Valley. It's based on a model from France. 42. We'll talk to the chief operating officer of that. And we're going to do the biggest unboxing we've ever done. It's a 4-ton unboxing. It's right out there. The new Tesla's here. So we're going to give you just kind of a quick tour, and then I'll do a more full review later on. But let's get started with the hot topics of the week. And Elon Musk is in the news. He has released stage two, or he said part deux, of his master plan.
He said he was going to stay up all night to do it. He made a joke about doing crack on Twitter, which is just typical classic Elon. And, you know, is that what you want for your master plan? To, like, I'm going to pull an all-nighter and then come up with my master plan? But I am actually a fan of his master plan.
I think Elon is pretty darn cool. And you know what? I don't think he cares what people think.
No, I don't think he does either. And he doesn't really need to.
He doesn't need to. He, of course, made a lot of money with PayPal, sold PayPal, and invested almost all of it into a couple of three companies, SpaceX, which has been doing great. In fact, that was what was keeping him from doing the master plan earlier. SpaceX launched a mission to resupply the International Space Station with a booster rocket that they had recovered, did one of those amazing upright landings. So really, really cool. And then he has helped with his cousins start a company called, a solar power company called
Solar City.
I should know because I have them on my roof. Solar City, thank you. So part of his plan is to buy Solar City and to create a giant sustainable company. The other thing he's doing is building the biggest battery plant in the world, the Gigafactory, almost open, and building and selling giant batteries for your home called Powerwall. And so it's all about, what is the master plan, the overarching plan?
Well, he wants to combine Solar City with Tesla, which makes sense. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like he wants to create this app store for power. Like, it's, you know, this is where you get all the power, and then they control it and they dole it out, which makes sense because we have solar on our house and I have no idea if I'm getting a deal or not. Like, it still has to go through the power company. He also Tesla Semi, which is like large
trucks and buses,
which totally makes sense. I mean, that's what's taking up a lot. I mean, if we can make those electric, it would be amazing for
and all of this was about bootstrapping. So you saw, we just scrolled through the original master plan, the first few steps, which are to build an expensive roadster, a low volume car, to bootstrap a medium volume car at a lower price, to create what he is about to create, an affordable high volume car, the Model 3, and then to provide solar power. And it really all goes together. The idea being, it's one thing to drive an electric car and kick the electricity problem down the road to a power plant. It's another thing entirely to generate your own electricity. If we put solar panels, certainly out here in the West, we have lots of sun on all the roofs, we could generate more electricity than we need. So I really like his plan, and the long-term plan is to make a sustainable future for his kids and our kids and grandkids. And who doesn't support that?
Right? So what about the part of the plan that says that Tesla owners can let other people drive their cars when they're not using them in order to make money?
Isn't that funny? The idea being that these cars, as they become autonomous, won't need drivers. It'll be like Uber, and I could just be part, you know, my car's sitting out there not doing anything. Most people have, you know, cars in garages. When they drive to work, they sit at work. Wouldn't it be cool if the car could drive itself, that somebody could summon it, use it, put it back, and that they would make money? I like this idea. Again, this is all about reducing the burden on the planet of making these cars, making transportation affordable, widely available. I think he's a brilliant guy. And he also plans to go to Mars, but that's not in the master plan. That's just his own person. And you know, part of this I think works because Tesla believes we're in a simulation. And he figures it's a low stakes game. Mm-hmm. You know, just reboot, game over, start over.
Do you believe we're in a simulation? Is that why you said you just share your Tesla? Because I heard you say you were going to share your Tesla.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I got nothing to lose at this point.
Okay. Great.
Speaking of nothing to lose, Twitter is now going to let everybody get a verified account. You'll have to send them some sort of proof of identity. But the blue check mark that is so far only been available to celebrities is now going to be available to everybody. I think this is Twitter trying to handle its anonymity problem.
Yes, I went through this because I do not have a blue check mark. I have a Wikipedia page, but I am not verified. You know, it's not just celebrities, tech journalists, you get them automatically. But in the past, there was no way to apply for it.
Right.
And it wasn't like you hit
a
certain
number
of followers and you got it. It was nothing. It was just this mysterious way. So I applied for it. Weirdly, I had been using my twit.tv email address. It wouldn't let me. I had to change my email address. I don't know why that was.
Well, because it's a company address?
Maybe? I guess so. But I changed my email address. I had to put down a bunch of websites. And I had to take a picture of my driver's license and send it in. And then now we just wait to see if I'm
so verified. You don't have it yet?
I do not have the blue check.
I think this is a good idea. Twitter's obviously got a problem with harassment. They've got a, you know, I'm starting to feel like in the long run, the problem is anonymity. And I know that the arguments are, you have to provide a place for people to communicate anonymously so that they, if they're whistleblowers or if they're fear for their life or whatever, they should be able to do this. And of course, when Google had a real names policy, it caused a lot of problems. They eventually backed down on it. Facebook had a real names policy. A lot of people said no, but you know, Dr. Kiki said, I'm not Kirsten Sanford, I'm Dr. Kiki. To most of the people who know me, I should be able to use not my real name, but my public name. I don't think that's the problem. The problem is people who are, you know, Pokemon 123, who are completely anonymous, who hide their identity, and then really feel they have permission now to say anything irresponsible that they want to. And that's really one of the problems Twitter's facing. Twitter is a hugely valuable resource, but it's a big problem for Twitter that they cannot control harassment online, things like that. Ironically, last week they banned the one guy, Milo, Nero, at Nero, who was using his real name, or was using his real identity, but they didn't ban all the trolls that he had marshaled to attack other people because they couldn't. They were anonymous.
Yeah.
And they just come right back.
Right.
So I feel for Twitter. I don't think it's an easy thing to solve. In fact, I've come to the opinion that there's no way to solve it. As long as you allow anonymity, you're going to have this problem. It's just nothing you can do.
I think you can solve it with kindness.
And how's that working for you?
It's working okay.
You're a very kind person.
I think you just the people in the world are mostly good. The people that are not good are sometimes louder. But like if you go and I think I get many more positive,
right,
we love what you're doing, thank you for what you're doing, right, than I get the negative. The negative is so small. It hurts more, but it's smaller.
Right.
And I think, you know, when Leslie Jones from Ghostbusters left Twitter in tears because of the racism and the harassment.
And that's what got Milo banned. Yeah.
Right, because he was part of it. And what particularly got him banned, he was part of a mob. He was inciting a mob. And so I like that they got rid of the leader of the mob. Sometimes, you know, the rest of the mob quiets down after it. They haven't in this case. But I mean, the amount of positive energy that was put towards her after she left and experienced this was amazing. And I think, I mean, I'm not a Pollyanna.
But she's still not on Twitter.
Yes, she is. She came back.
She came back.
She came back. She did.
And by the way, she will continue to get harassed. That's the thing.
She was, yeah.
Yeah. If you're on Twitter, you're going to get harassed. There's nothing you can do about it.
Right.
Nothing Twitter can do about it.
But there's one thing to be harassed, but then to be have fake accounts, making people think that, you know, impersonating you, that's, I think, where it was taking it too far.
And they're able to do. They're able to get rid of that. Although, again, as supporters of free speech, they do allow parody accounts, and that's been a source of pain for people like our own Jeff Jarvis. And that's not against the rules on Twitter, and probably shouldn't be. I think parody is protected. It's part of free speech. It's just difficult.
I think it's
really a challenge. And just knock it off. Be nice. Why are you not being nice? Why are you being so mean? And the truth is, you know, what people as men receive is nothing compared to the abuse that women receive on these internet
and women of color receive worse.
And it's even worse.
Yes.
So there's no excuse for that. Mm-hmm. I am not going to say ha ha, but I'm tempted. No, I'm not. This is not a good thing. But for a long time, in fact, still, with older Android phones, there was a real problem with a media player that allows somebody to send you an evil MMS message that would let them take over your Android device. Google patched it. It was called the stage fright bug. Google patched it as quick as they could, but they could only patch it on newer devices. It was up to the manufacturers and the carriers to patch older devices. They haven't. That bug persists. Now there's a similar bug on iOS. It lets hackers access and take over your iPhone by sending a malware iMessage, a specially crafted iMessage. And it's the media renderer. It's funny. It's the same exact problem that was happening on Android. The difference is Apple could fix it because there's only one company that makes Apple phones, and they did. And by the way, it wasn't just phones. It was OS X, too.
iPads as well.
And iPads. So they didn't. So the people who discovered it told Apple before they went public. Apple had a chance to fix it. And if you've been updated, and everybody should update your OS X and your iOS devices, you're not vulnerable, right?
Right. Exactly. So yeah, that is the benefit. One of the benefits of Apple, like you can one fell swoop, you can update it. You don't have to go through all the rigmarole that you do with Android phones.
Android is at the mercy of the manufacturers and the carriers. Google can't fix everything. Hey, you want to take a walk?
I would love to take a walk.
Okay. We have two ways we could go. A left turn is to the Tesla. A right turn, I think I see a Pikachu. Let's go on over here. We're going to talk about, yes, Pokémon Go, but the technical side of Pokémon Go. We've got two experts joining us. First, sitting to our your left, my right, Laurie Voss. He's the founder and CEO of NPM Incorporated, an open source project a lot of us use to install software.
Cool.
And also on the phone right now via Skype, Michael Christopher. He is. Are you a developer, Michael? What's your story?
Yeah, I'm a developer. Most of my experience is actually in the video space.
Okay.
I kind of do everything. I'm back end primarily.
So the first thing I want to ask Laurie a little bit about is, I'm sure this isn't Niantic's desire, but it's been very hard to play Pokémon Go ever since it came out on July 6th. They clearly didn't anticipate the demand, but once they had the demand, why couldn't they just put a bunch of servers online and fix it?
That's an excellent question. The people who work at Niantic was spun off of Google. They're ex-Googlers, so they know what they're doing when it comes to scale. Google has no problems building things that are very, very big. So there's a couple of clues in the way the game fails that are indicating where they've created these single points of failure, these bottlenecks that are probably holding up the game. The first couple of days, people saw that it would fail at login a lot of the time.
Right.
Which suggests that, you know, the thing that they hadn't anticipated is, you know, 10 or 100 times as many people trying to log in just in the first place. The login server is not usually like the busiest part of your game because you only log in once and then you go. But once your login server starts to fail, people are constantly trying to log back in.
Making it worse.
Right. So it's a very common problem that the login server, if the login server is fine, everything is perfect. But if the login server is even a little bit flaky, it goes from flaky to down.
It doesn't matter what's behind the front door if the front door won't open.
Right. So everyone was smacking into the front door. And after that, the next thing is you see a lot of errors about failed to download the game data. And the game data is like the current state of the player. And again, it's this thing, you should only need to do that once, but if the servers are already flaky, then people are doing it a lot more often than you would have expected they would do.
So these are kind of cascading failures.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's how a big system like this fails. Right. It's never just one thing. It's, one thing that wasn't supposed to happen is happening all the time, so these other three things that you never thought would happen are now happening constantly.
Michael, you might have a little expertise on the kind of unusual nature of this game, because Michael, along with others, reverse engineered the API to create a map mashup that shows you where Pokemon are anywhere in the world in real time. First of all, how did you do that?
So there was a community on Reddit called Pokemon Dev that right after the game came out basically started reverse engineering the game, decompiling the APKs for Android, and then looking at how things worked underneath the covers. And what we found is that it was very similar to Ingress, which has a huge community of developers and is kind of well understood in the space.
And that's not a surprise. Niantic created Ingress. And right. In fact, Pokemon Go, I think it's fair to say, is really a skinned Ingress. I mean, it's just Pokemon added to Ingress. It's a very similar game.
In fact, the database of Pokestops and gyms are basically identical.
Yeah, to the Ingress.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
So you were able to kind of presume that they must be doing something similar. But what's interesting is that this isn't like Twitter, where you go to a server, you put something, and then it has to replicate it. And this is a little more complicated. It looks like they have a Maps API, they have an OAuth API. They have a lot of pieces in this puzzle. Does that make it less reliable?
If you're building something at scale, you're generally going to build what's called a distributed system. You're going to have split. You know, you're not going to have all of your logic in one place. You can have lots of different types of servers, right? So it's not going to be this one server that does the login and the game and the map and the Pokemon. Like, each one of those is a different type of server. You can see from the way that the game has changed since it launched that they are doing things with the different types of servers that failed. So the login servers,
right?
It seems like they helped that out. They made it so you had to log in much less often. Uh-huh. You were talking about how the radar suddenly got a lot less granular. If you think about
that's a hard thing to do.
Right. If you're familiar with how maps work, having a real-time map that moves stuff around, that's really computationally expensive. So if you make the map really inaccurate, which is what they did with the radar, that would probably reduce the load on the maps. Probably what they were doing there.
They've mostly fixed it. In fact, yesterday we thought this is going to be a calamity because Japan went online, right? And actually, yesterday was one of the best days of the week. Monday, it had been down almost all day. So they are making progress with this. Do you see this in your own map? I mean, are you, Michael, are you hit by server issues as well?
So it's an interesting topic. Radar, for example, is actually, the changes that they made are 100% client-side. When we talk to the API, we get a latitude and longitude for every single item on the map.
So they still have the capability.
Yeah. And it's interesting because the fact that radar is now broken in the client has been the number one cause for people to download the app.
I guess what you're saying, Laurie, makes sense that it was a very challenging, thing to do. Mm-hmm. But I also think they did it to keep people from walking off cliffs chasing rare Pokemon. The radar has to have been one of the main reasons people got in trouble playing Pokemon Go, because instead of just getting whatever is nearby, your map too, Michael, they're going off saying, yeah, I gotta get a Vaporeon and it's over there, and they're going to find it.
Yep. The plus side with the map is, at least, if you're going to go stand in the area where the Pokemon is, you don't have to walk off the cliff. You can go stand there, open the app, and it's going to show up.
Thank goodness.
And it's a can you run this on mobile as well? Is it
The desktop application that I created can be accessed via mobile, okay, via a tunnel.
It's a web. You have to tunnel to it. It's not.
Yeah, okay. There's a tunneling mechanism built into the app.
Oh, okay,
but it is desktop kind of primary. The community in general is working very hard to get everything web-based. The problem is the scale. As Laurie was talking about, the scale of that data is immense, and creating databases that don't go down when you've got hundreds of thousands or millions of people trying to query them in real time
Not easy.
Is a hard problem.
And yet, I would think it'd be solved. I mean, Twitter had fail whales a lot in the early days. They re-architected somehow. I don't know how. Mm-hmm. And they don't have fail whales anymore. Mm-hmm. Facebook, which would arguably have the worst problem of all with 1.5 billion monthly active users, seems to be pretty reliable, right? Mm-hmm. You don't see fail whales. So aren't these problems well-known and solvable?
So I think we were talking about this earlier. I think what caught them by surprise was how much more popular Pokemon was than any mobile game has ever been before, right?
Apple says it's the... What did Apple say?
It was the biggest... In the first week, it was the biggest
of any game ever.
Right.
The App Store, yeah.
So if you're a smart developer, you're like, all right, this is Pokemon. It's going to be super popular. Let's make our servers scale to match the biggest mobile game that's ever existed. And you do, you know, whatever, however many servers
wasn't
you need.
Enough.
And they got 10 times that many.
Right.
Like, I feel for them. Like, you know, even if you were really doing your homework, nobody predicted how big this was going to be.
So in a day or two, they noticed.
Yeah.
Right? And they have money because they're making money. Mm-hmm. I would imagine pretty good money at this point on this thing. Can't they just buy more servers?
It depends how you've architected the thing. If you've built it to scale horizontally, is the term, then you should be able to just, you know, make it twice as big by spinning up twice as many servers. But making an application that can truly scale horizontally, that really doesn't have any, you know, one single point of failure, something that everything depends on.
Dependencies are the problem.
Login and authentication are often the problem because you can't distribute them, right? Like, you know, the definition of what your password is, it can't live in two places
right.
at once because you can only have one password.
Right.
So that has to be, ultimately, there has to be one source of truth for that. And unless you really do your homework to shard that database and split it into a million pieces, that's often going to be where you're going to hit a point of failure in a distributed system like this, especially if you thought you could get away with it, right? If you thought it was only going to be 10 million people and it turned out to be 100 million people, you probably wouldn't have done all that extra effort to split that database up in the way that you need to.
Right.
You can do it, but it's not a problem you can fix in 2 weeks. You have to re-architect.
Michael, were you able in reverse engineering this? Were you able to kind of deduce what their technology stack is?
I actually wanted to talk about
go ahead, yes. Talk about what you want to talk about.
On the login circuit, sorry, that was just what we've noticed in kind of this reverse engineering process is that is still run by Nintendo. And I don't think Nintendo was well equipped to handle the influx of
There were two logins, right? You could use a Pokemon Trainer login. That broke almost instantly.
Right.
But there was also a Google OAuth login, right?
That actually goes and talks to the Pokemon single sign-on.
Yeah, the game data is still,
everything
still on Nintendo.
Flows through. Basically, you have Pokemon Trainer Club and you have Google OAuth. Those go into Pokemon single sign-on. And then that gets an authentication ticket that can be sent over to the
Wasn't OAuth service. That was breaking. That makes sense because I could still use Google OAuth on other sites without a problem.
Right. It was once you had the identifier, you'd go into Nintendo servers and try and get the game data, and Nintendo was like, we weren't expecting
what
this. What
the what? What's going on?
So was it an issue of Niantic and Nintendo not communicating?
I think, like I said, I think they communicated and they just didn't understand how big this was going to be.
Yeah, it went viral. I mean, just the idea of everyone sharing screenshots and, you know, you can't
expect that. People who've never played Pokemon before, like myself, are obsessed with this game. Who thought that was going to happen?
and it's a little telling that they were able to launch in Japan with much fewer problems.
Mm-hmm.
And that has to be the biggest country of all for Pokemon. Right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I can only imagine the enthusiasm.
Michael, what does Niantic think about your map?
So officially everything that we are doing is using a private API. So they haven't officially.
There's no public API. You just figured out what they were doing.
Right. Yeah. This is all reverse engineering.
Oh boy.
So we're basically calling these same APIs the game is calling, in a way that is very much against the terms of service.
Well,
of the
then
game.
You're part of the problem. You're probably.
Well, yeah, and given the way that the map applications work, you basically put your player in the map and then move it around very, very rapidly in order to generate the data. Those applications are all putting a much higher load on at least the read portion of the API.
Could they shut you down easily, or?
It remains to be seen.
It's possible they can't tell it's you, right?
Well, they shouldn't be able to tell that we're pulling the data, but if you log in with your own account, there's basically two big payloads we're seeing in the actual API request response cycle. One of those we've decoded, and one of those is the game data. It's the player profile, it's the statistics, it's your bag, it's all that kind of stuff. It's the map state. And then there's another one that's been encrypted that a whole bunch of people are still trying to work out what exactly is in that payload. But we suspect it's either a logging and analytics data, or it's some kind of anti-cheat mechanism. So far, nobody's gotten banned for using this, but the expectation is that that will come. So
if I use my account, I have caught three. I'm on level three, so I should not. I should use a different account, or else I'll lose all four Pokemon that I've caught.
She's a learner. She's just beginning. Well, that's not Michael. That is Michael Christopher is not his real name. That's actually not how he looks, and we believe he's somewhere in Saskatoon.
Yeah, we scrambled his voice.
Yeah. And so no one will ever know. Are you a little worried that you're going to get a little knock on the door at some point?
No, it's we're going against the terms of service, but I don't
think
anybody
can get thrown in jail for that.
Yeah.
And it's kind of fun, isn't it?
Of course.
what a fun. You know, is it still under development? Or I mean, is the Reddit group still working
very
hard?
Very active. The goal right now is actually to build a single unified data store of all Pokemon actions and everything going on in the system that are.
Why not, right?
Variable.
Might as well.
There's a bunch of people that are working on big data analytics right now and trying to map. And
yeah, you need MapReduce, and it'd be easy, right? No problem at all. Yeah. What database are they using? Do you know, Laurie?
Nobody who's actually working on the game will talk to me.
Yeah.
But the people who
I bet it's not Oracle though. I'm just thinking.
The people who work at Google and knew what Ingress was doing before Ingress spun out. They say it's something like Bigtable. Google has its own internal, very large scale database. I don't know if it's the commercial one that Google offers, because Google offers a commercial Bigtable now.
Right.
But it would be something along those lines—a very large cloud database. Yeah. Very simple features, very scalable.
And it's designed to handle all of the spidered links and be able to quickly search through those. So it's highly responsive, highly distributed.
Right. It's meant to not do very much, but do it for
fast.
Enormous numbers of people.
Yeah. Wow. It's kind of it's fun. This is the meta Pokemon Go game. You could be like that, or you could reverse engineer the whole thing and create a super map that everybody could use and figure out where the Pokemon is. And I think that sounds like an even more fun game. You guys are great. Thank you, Michael, for joining us. Where can people find your map?
It's on GitHub. GitHub.com/mchristopher/PokemonGoDesktopMap.
Do you want people to fork it and do their own thing?
Yeah, that'd be great. We've gotten over 160,000 downloads in the past days.
What kind of a language?
It's an Elixir application that wraps a Python application that is being worked on frequently by the community. But anybody is welcome to jump in and encouraged.
I think what you need to do is make an NPM package so that everybody can install this on their own system.
There's a couple NPM packages already. There's one that tells you whether or not Pokemon servers are up or down.
Nice. I love it. NPM, you probably already use it. You don't have to even be a developer, but if you use open source systems at all, very frequently you'll need to install something using the Node package. I call it the Node package manager. It doesn't stand for that. It's just NPM. And I'm so glad you could join us. Laurie Voss is founder and COO of NPM. So you were one of the original devs on NPM?
No, I'm very much a newcomer. My connection to NPM is that Isaac Schluter, who did invent NPM, we go way back. And when NPM needed to become a company, he was like, I know how to build NPM. You know how to run a company. Can you help me out?
I've heard of people doing that. It's very effective. Thank you, Laurie. Thank you, Michael. Great to talk to you both. It's kind of fun to see, kind of peek behind the pokey curtain and see what's going on. Coming up, Brittany Beer is going to join us from the Tuition-Free School for Developers. If you want to be a person like Laurie and Michael, be a developer yourself, there's a way you can get started. It's absolutely free, and it all starts with a logic test. We'll tell you how to take that in a second. But first, I want to talk about getting a free book from Audible.com. I'm a huge Audible listener. First thing I do, get in the new car, pair my phone to the new car so I can be listening to my audio books. Man, it sounds good. audiobooks everywhere I go, because there are plenty of times when you're driving, when you're working out, when you're walking the dog or washing the dishes, you can't hold a book, but you'd love to listen. Man, my Amazon Echo, that's almost 90% of what I use it for, is reading my audiobooks to me. And I love audiobooks on Audible, whether it's fiction or nonfiction, historic stuff. You can take college classes, you can laugh to comedy performances. They have more than 250,000 downloadable titles across all types of literature, and they even offer language instruction and foreign language audiobooks. So if you want to learn a new language, they've got Pimsleur on there. They've got several different language series on there. You can, that's also part of your Audible subscription. What we're going to do is we're going to set you up with a book a month plan. That's the gold account, by going to audible.com/NSS for new screensavers. Audible.com/NSS. You'll also get the Daily Digest of the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. Lots of content. What I want you to do, though, is pick a great book, something that you know, like Ready Player One. What a great book that would be. Something that's engaging and fun, so you can get a sense of how it is to listen to a book instead of reading it on the printed page or on a Kindle. It really comes to life for you. Ready Player One's a great example. That, your heart will start pounding in the first chapter. I mean, it's really, really exciting, and you'll see why it's so great to listen. Now, you have 30 days. You can cancel any time in that first 30 days. You'll pay absolutely nothing. That book is going to be yours forever, though. That's why we call it a free book. Audible.com/NSS. I bet we have to take a break here and find out what's going on with Father Robert Ballecer. He went to the Wearable Tech Conference in San Jose and has this report.
Thanks, Leo. Thanks, Megan. We're here at the Wearable Technology Conference in San Jose, California, taking a look at, the future of wearable and IoT technology. And speaking of that future, there have been a few products that have really caught my eye. The first one is this. No, this is not just a piece of junky plastic. This is actually a PCB. This is what you would put your project on. Now, right now, a wearable piece of technology is typically a standard PCB that they put into some sort of soft enclosure so that it can be attached to your body. In this particular case, the substrate is flexible enough, and yes, this does work like a regular PCB, a photosensitive device that allows you to print and then remove the material you don't need, but it can also house all the ICs, capacitors, resistors, and even the battery power that you need to make that next generation wearable. Look for more of this technology to make its way into the market. Now, it's not just about PCBs. There's also the question of power. How do you provide power to devices that should be collecting all the time? Delta Microelectronics has come up with a way of using the free power in the air. Now, this is not some sort of scam. This module actually harvests 2.4 gigahertz RF energy. You may know that as Wi-Fi. It's abundant, it's everywhere, and it provides enough power using specialized capacitors and an IC that cycles those capacitors to give you Bluetooth, low power Bluetooth connectivity. So I could use this as, say, a sensor to detect temperature over time. Of course, it's not just RF energy. They also have things like this. This uses a thermocouple so I can actually harvest the energy from my body, the heat, and it transmits little pieces of data to a station that might be collecting my heart rate or my blood pressure. Very interesting use of alternative technologies for power. And finally, there's this, the ability to turn physical motion into power. In other words, a switch that provides power for the circuit it controls. Finally, there's this. It's not just all about the background technology. Sometimes you just need a really cool set of AR goggles. This is from Viewfind. This allows me to take any HDMI input and have it as an AR headset. I've been selling this as a supplement to Pokémon Go for those players who are tired of walking into walls and people and traffic. So if you are looking for the future of wearable technology, it's here in San Jose. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the host of Know How on the Twit TV network. Back to the studio, you, Leo, and Megan.
We talk a lot about learning to code. Can you do it online? Can you use an app to do it? We talk about coding boot camps. But I think if you really want to become a developer, sometimes you have to go to school, but it's expensive. 42 is a new tuition-free school, and we have the COO, Brittany Beer, here to talk to us about it. Welcome, Brittany.
Thank you.
So tell us what 42 is.
So 42 is a nonprofit tuition-free coding university. Now, I know there's been a lot of different coding camps and different coding institutions that have been throwing around the words tuition-free. But then there's always a catch at the end saying that, okay, well, once you leave, you will be paying us a certain sum of your salary, things like that. When we say tuition-free, we actually do mean tuition-free here at 42 USC.
So how are you supported?
So we are financially founded and funded by Xavier Niel, who is a French billionaire and philanthropist who has also funded and founded 42 in Paris, France.
That's where it started.
That's where it started in July 2013.
And you are a 42 graduate. How did you get involved today?
So I got involved with 42 in Paris as I was teaching at a computer university. And when I heard that 42 was opening up, I thought rather than being the English teacher that I was at the computer university, I wanted my turn at being a student and being able to learn at 42. So I applied.
So you had actually gotten a college degree and you said—
In Spanish. That's really good, yeah. It really prepares you.
Exactly, to live in France and study code.
And you wanted to go to graduate school, but you know, you'd heard how you didn't want to get yourself in debt, so you just started going back to work, and then now you found 42.
Well, actually, I wanted to go to graduate school, but what happened was I was living in the United States at that time, and my options were very limited here, meaning that in the United States, our tuition is so expensive that it puts up barriers for individuals to be able to access education. So my options were very limited. It was either quit school or move abroad, which is a very drastic decision that I had to make, but that's what I made. So when I went to France, it was originally to study for my master's degree, which I did go ahead and complete, and then I found 42.
So what's the process of becoming a student at 42? Where do we begin?
So we begin on our website, 42.us.org. There we have two logic tests that students will go through and complete. So they are there to test if a student has a programming logical state of mind. Not necessarily if they have previous technology skills. We're not testing for their SAT scores. We're not testing if they have a certain type of diploma, if they fit into a certain category. What we're just trying to see is, do they have a logical state of mind, and would they be potentially successful in a program like this?
That makes sense. You don't want somebody who just doesn't have the base skills needed. But assuming they pass, then what's the next step?
So once they pass, we invite them to a check-in where they would come and they would learn a little bit more about our university. And then we have what's called our PCN. So our PCN is a four-week intensive coding session.
PCN?
PCN, which means swimming pool in English. So it's this kind of idea that for 4 weeks, you are going to be trying out our program. We call it our free trial. So it's where individuals can come and try out the university for 4 weeks, see if it's a good fit for them, see if we are a good fit for them.
And what do you learn in that first month?
And so during that first month, we start off with C language. So we start off with C, and the individuals have a series of exercises that they build upon each and every day. And they continue working until the end of the PCN. So it's 4 weeks, though, 7 days a week, and typically
individuals... Oh, you don't get weekends?
No weekends. That would be too easy. So typically individuals actually spend 10 to 15 hours a day during the PCN, so it is very intensive, but it is to prepare them and to see how well they will cope with this kind of environment, how well will they be able to adapt, and will they be able to progress in such an environment.
That's amazing, because I think a huge problem with dropout is people who just don't make it through, in regular colleges too, they just don't make it through the first, you know, they're just not prepared. So that's great that you have that. So there are no requirements. You don't have to be, you don't have to have a high school degree, you don't have to have a college degree.
You don't even have to have a high school degree?
No, you do not.
Just basically walk in the door and say, I'm here.
As long as you're 18.
After you take the test.
The age is 18 through 30, so you can't do it, Leo.
Oh, I was looking for a career.
We do have 18 to 30 as our age requirement for the time being. This has been something that we've been very successful with. My colleagues have been in education since the early 1990s, and for the time commitment that is required to complete 42, that is one of the entry requirements that we have.
You need the stamina and the ability to work 15 hours a day for 7 days a week, and that's going to be younger people with no life. No Pokemon Go allowed.
Yeah. No mortgages.
However, we do have a new program that we are trying out in Paris for individuals that are over 30 and who have been unemployed for several years. That's currently a project that we're working on with Pôle emploi, which is the French unemployment agency.
You know, in France, the educational system is very rigid. And it's old-fashioned. It's very traditional. I remember when my daughter was a high school student there, her sister, the family she was staying with, was 16. She wanted to be a doctor. She had to take a test at 16 and enter the medical fac to become a doctor, and that's it. You either make it or you don't at 16, and then you have no choices later. That's the way it works. This is very different.
Yes, this is very different, and it's opening up a world of opportunity to individuals that normally wouldn't have such an opportunity. This is providing opportunities to different talents, also individuals who don't necessarily fit into the traditional school system, who feel disengaged by sitting by passively listening to different lectures, sitting in classes.
This is all hands-on?
There are no teachers, right? Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so there are no teachers. We're entirely project-based, peer-to-peer pedagogy. So what students will be doing when they're here at 42 is they will actually be working on projects. So they're actively participating in their education and working on projects that are equivalent or simulate what it is they are going to be doing once they leave 42 and go out into the actual job world.
This is so cool.
Yeah. Well, so 42, it's named 42 after the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, right? The answer to everything.
Of course.
And, I mean, and you've gotten a lot of great feedback from Evan Spiegel, from Snapchat. Jack Dorsey endorsed you, so many others, the founder of Airbnb.
Well, this is a real issue for these companies because they need highly trained people who are ready to enter the workforce and work hard. And so you're providing, I'm sure, was Xavier Niel, did he come from a tech background? Is that where he made his money?
So yes, he did make his money. He founded a telecommunications company, which provided one of the first boxes with TV, internet, and landline services available. So his company actually in France is called Free, which is free. So he kind of disrupted this industry and created this three-in-one system for a very low price.
I'm going to send this link to Henry. He's going to be out of college with a degree in philosophy or something in a year, and I think this would be great for at least the boot camp, right? The piscine, at least try and see, and he might find, hey, I really like programming.
Exactly.
And if not, what has he lost? A month of time and no money at all.
Yeah.
Where are you located?
So we're located in Fremont, California at 6600 Dumbarton Circle.
And there's a dorms. There's some free dorms as well.
Free dorms?
And the students just have to pay for meals. Is that correct?
Yes, exactly. Amazing. So we also have 300 dorm spaces which are available for individuals who would like to come to 42. And then we have our cafeteria staff offers a meal plan for the students as well.
How many people at a time does in any given PC?
So right now, we're currently waiting for construction to finish on half of the building, but we will have 1,024 workstations available on the top floor only.
1K, exactly. That's great. And then after you, if you go through the PC and you do well, is there grades? What is the measure of doing well?
So the measure of doing well is the project functional and
does
is
it work?
Is it doing what it's supposed to do? Right. So oftentimes in a traditional university, we tend to procrastinate until the last minute when we have a due date. And the night before, we pull out the Red Bull, pull out the coffee, and are like, okay, let's finally get this project done. And the next morning, you turn in the project, it's horrible, and your professor is just crying late at night because she has to grade your project, and it's just not good. But here at 42, what we want is that students take the time that they need to learn a project. So this is why we don't have time barriers on the individual projects that the students need to complete. So once they do complete it, we ask that other individuals in the community are selected to then grade them. So we have peer-to-peer learning, peer-to-peer correcting, and those individuals will be looking at the subject that was given to the students, making sure that they have fulfilled all the requirements for that project, that it's functional, that they can't break the project. And it's either a pass or fail basis. And so it's not pass or fail at 50%, it's pass or fail at a much higher level. So we want to make sure that what these projects that individuals are turning out would be projects that it's acceptable to turn out in a job.
Mm-hmm. Well, so you have a humanities background, but there's no humanities requirement at all. do you get that? That like, you know, what do you say to turning out these developers that have no basic like humanities classes in order to go out in the working world?
Well, I think it's actually wonderful that individuals who come into the program come from all different backgrounds. We have individuals that have gone through and done humanities. We have one individual he's gone through and gotten a law degree. Others who have done philosophy. We have a PhD in philosophy in Paris, France right now. And we have others who have not completed their high school diploma, who fell out of the school system and found 42 as an opportunity.
It makes sense. You're looking for people with the skills to do this professionally.
Exactly.
In exactly the kind of environment that they're going to have to do it professionally in. So if you pass, are you then invited to the five-year program? What's next?
Yes. So if you pass the PSCene, we will invite them to a 3 to 5 year program. So we say 3 to 5 years because the projects do not have time limits. Some individuals may complete it a little bit earlier. Some individuals may take a little bit longer. So once they have completed the PSCene, they will be able to select when it is they would like to come to the 3 to 5 year program. So they can start this year, they can start next year, they can start whenever in life is best for them.
And it's free for the 3 to 5 year program as well?
Yes, it's free for the 3 to 5 year program.
You don't have to give away your firstborn child or anything like that.
What if you create, and I imagine this is part of it, maybe Mr. Neil is interested in a product. Let's say you created Snapchat at this school. Would he then have rights to the product?
No. Students that create projects while they're at 42, all the code that they create is theirs, yes.
I can see no reason not to do this. I'm going to have to turn the clock back and turn into a 30-year-old. This sounds like a really wonderful thing. Are there plans to expand beyond California?
So at this time, we've got our school in Paris and our school in California. Right now, we're just going to be focusing on our school that's here in California, and then perhaps maybe in the future, we'll look at expanding.
See how it goes, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's exciting.
Thank you so much for coming on. This
Thank
is great.
You.
Find out more at 42.u. What is it? U.
42.us.org.
42.us.org. And you can take the test and see if you're logical and then decide if maybe you want to take the next step. Mm-hmm. How? It sounds scary, but it also sounds challenging and fun. Mm-hmm. It actually sounds like fun, right?
It does. Yeah.
You make some great friends.
It looks, seems like a great place.
How many women? How diverse is the class?
So let me think. Currently, right now, in this particular PSCene, we have 19% women. So that is actually quite a lot more than some of the other universities. In Paris, France, I believe we have 10%. And in previous schools that I've worked at, it was anywhere from 3 to 7%.
So you're making progress.
And it's a blind application program. I mean, you don't know the gender.
So it's really up to
you.
We do actually know the gender beforehand, but the program is completely automated. So it doesn't necessarily check if you're a woman or a man. It just checks, did you pass or fail? It's a very binary system.
So gender neutral.
Gender neutral.
As diverse as anybody wants to make
it. As diverse as anybody wants to make it. So it's up to the individuals who want to apply, and voila.
I'm telling you, I'm sending a note to Henry today. At least take the test. He'll take the test because that sounds like fun.
Yeah, exactly.
And we can compete. I could see how he does compared to his dad. Thank you so much. It's so nice to meet you. Brittany Beer is the COO of 42 USA. I think it's great to see innovations in education. I'm sure you agree. This isn't the only way, but this sounds like for some people to be a great way and no cost. It really gives opportunity to anybody. I think that's really great.
It might be the answer to everything.
42. What's the question? The life, universe, and everything. Thank you, Brittany. We really, really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
If you who's hosting the show with me next week? Jason Howell. Oh, my gosh. It's like a T&T trifecta.
Yep.
Jason Howell will be here next week. Of course, he's a big musician. He's big on Android. If you've got a question for me and Jason, here's how you can ask it.
Need tech help? The new screensavers are here with answers. Email your tech questions to newscreensavers@twit.tv.
Our show today, this is another thing that you're going to do in life that's pass or fail. Save for your future. You don't want to get to my age and have no retirement plan. You don't want your kids to get to college age and have no savings for college. You want to be able to buy a house What about emergency funds? You've got to have long-term savings. And the best way to do it, wealthfront.com. Why? Well, the choices are obvious. You could do it yourself. You know, you're going to have to invest, right? That's clear. You can't just put it in the mattress. You could do it yourself. You could study up. That's what I did. I thought, I'm smart. I could read every book. I did. And then I put the money away. I did the right thing and then forgot about it for 10 years. Yeah, no, it actually takes kind of regular maintenance of this stuff. Oh, I know. We'll hire a broker, a financial advisor. So that guy down on the strip mall down the street, he'd be great, wouldn't he? Well, on the one hand, you got to wonder, why is he on a strip mall down the street if he's so good at investing? But on the other, he's going to charge you not a little either, 1, 2, up to 3% of what you've got invested every year, plus hidden fees and transaction charges. And that means you got to make that much more just to break even. Not a good solution. Wealthfront's great because it's computerized. The software's doing the maintenance, the trading. That has two advantages. One, it's constantly monitoring your investment every minute, every hour, every day. And you can see online exactly what trades it's making on your behalf, looking to maximize your return, minimize your tax bill. And it's based on this great leading books, leading research. Their board of advisors is amazing. Nobel Prize winning academic research, the best investment practices encapsulated in the software. The other advantage, software works cheap. Like not 1 or 2 or 3% a year of what you have on your investment, but 1/4 of 1%. 1/4 of 1%. So the cost is low, the benefits are high. And if you look at wealthfront.com/NSS, you will see how well they do for their customers. But I'm not suggesting you become a customer just yet. Go there, read up. I want you to know what you're getting into. Wealthfront.com/NSS. They will do a couple of things. One, they'll put you through the questionnaire process. Very short, by the way. They've really boiled it down to just a few questions about your time frame, how risk adverse you are. They will generate a sample portfolio for you, so you know exactly what they would start with you with, what kind of investments they make. They will also, and they'll do this free too, take your existing portfolio, analyze it, tell you how diversified you are, if it's at risk, what you're losing to fees, how you could minimize taxes. All of that is part of their free services. So at least do that. They just introduced their 529 college savings plan. So if you're saving for college for your kids or your grandkids, this is a government-approved college savings plan that allows you to invest after-tax dollars. It's like kind of like a Roth IRA for college savings. It's a really good program. They also have, you know, they have all, you know, joint retirement, long-term investments of all kinds. It's not day trading. This is long-term. If you decide you like it, minimum investment, a mere $500. Very easy just to dip your toe in the water. But here is the best part. Your first $15,000 is free of charge. Not just for the first year, but forever. So not 1/4 of 1%, but zero for life. $15,000, no cost at all. So what a great way to start your nest egg. We know so many listeners, so many viewers who have had great success with Wealthfront. They write to us every day. They're very happy with it. I think you will be too. Wealthfront.com/NSS. All right, it's going to be the biggest unboxing we've ever done. A 4-ton unboxing. We're going to go outside, actually, take a look at the Tesla Model X. Not a review yet. I want to take some time with it, as I would with any product. But I'll give you a little tour, at least a first look, and unbox the Model X. But first, Bryan, Burnett. He's going to show you how you can take a Raspberry Pi, $35 Raspberry Pi, and turn it into a security camera. Watch.
Bryan Burnett here from Know How, and here's how you build yourself a Raspberry Pi security cam. So the only parts you're going to need is a Raspberry Pi, obviously. I'm using a Model B Revision 2.0, means it has 512 megabytes of RAM, but you'll also need a micro SD card, 8 gigabytes or higher, a webcam. I'm using a Logitech HD webcam C520, and just a USB with external power supply. The first step for setting up your Raspberry Pi is format your SD card, download Raspbian Jesse Lite, and then also download WinDisk Imager. This way you can copy Jesse over to the SD card and insert it into the Raspberry Pi and boot it up. The first command you want to use is ifconfig, and this will allow you to see your IP address, which we will need later for being able to remote log into the Pi. The next step is to enable SSH and make room on the card. So type in sudo raspberrypi-config, and that'll bring you to the menu system where you can enable SSH and also format the card so that the OS uses up the entire volume. I'll be using PuTTY to remote into the Raspberry Pi from a local computer. And what I'll do is type in the IP address that I copied down earlier on port 22, hit enter, enter in your password information to log into the Pi. The default password for the Raspberry Pi is login Pi password Raspberry. And then the next command you'll want to do is sudo apt-get update, and then followed with sudo apt-get upgrade. Next, we will be installing the software that allow us to turn our webcam into a security camera, and it's called Motion. So the command you'll run is sudo apt-get install motion. Now we have to configure Motion. The next command you'll run is sudo nano slash etc slash motions.conf. As you drill down through the options, the things that you'll want to change is output underscore pictures to off, FFmpeg underscore output movies set to off, stream max rate to 30, and stream localhost off. Then hit Control X to save. To set motion to begin at startup, type in sudo nano slash etc slash default slash motion. Then copy over start underscore motion underscore daemon equals yes. With this enabled, when you first turn on the Pi, it should cycle through with the booting up motion and turn on your webcam. To view the webcam, enter in the IP address of the Raspberry Pi in your browser with colon 8081, that's the port, and you'll be should be able to see footage coming from the Pi. And that's the basics of using a webcam to monitor from a Raspberry Pi. For more projects like this, be sure to watch Know How.
Thank you, Bryan Burnett. Megan, we're standing outside. Can
we
you explain
are.
Why? I don't
know. It looks like Santa Claus brought me a Tesla.
I'll never forget. It was almost 10 years ago. One of our viewers brought his new Tesla Roadster for us to try to drive around. It was really cool. And I thought even then, boy, I'd love a car like this. But it's very expensive. And, you know, I like the idea of an electric car, but I want something a little bit more comfortable. Shortly thereafter, Tesla released its sedan, the Model S. And last year, in fact, September 30th of last year, they started shipping a brand new crossover SUV. It's called the Model X. Same idea. It's a fully electric car, and it has the longest range. Well, maybe there'll be a Chevy Bolt later this year that'll have comparable range, but at this point, 250-mile range between charges. Tesla's also realized that one of the big issues with electric cars is charging, like what they call it, range anxiety. I'm driving along. Where am I going to? I can't get stop at a gas station. Where am I going to get power? So they've built superchargers all over the country. They're very predominant in this area. We even have one here in Petaluma. That's a free place to go, and within an hour, fill up your tank, or your batteries in this case. So that was what put me over the top. Yeah. I thought, well, maybe I should try a Tesla. And also, we wanted to take a look at the autopilot feature. So I wish I had a box to take this out of. I don't, this is
that would be a lot of styrofoam
this
peanuts.
Is the Model X. This is kind of fun. The fob looks just like a miniature Model X. And ladies and gentlemen, I shall now try the command. Open the pod bay door, Hal. And here it comes.
Nice.
This is the Falcon Wing door.
Falcon Wing doors.
And they call it, it's not a gull wing, although it looks like the gull wing on the DeLorean, because it's articulated here. It has a joint. And so it can open even with just about a foot of clearance by sliding up and out.
So small garages, great for small garages.
Yeah, they say it takes even less space than, it's certainly than a regular door, but even like a sliding door. And I have to say, we have a fairly small garage. It fits in pretty well. This is the six-seater. So it's fully electric. It drives like a dream, has amazing acceleration. If you get the ludicrous mode, the Model X will go 0 to 60 in 3.2 seconds. I did not get the ludicrous mode. You'll see that big 17-inch screen there. That is how you control it. In fact, if you look at the dashboard, you'll see there's no knobs at all. It's all done through that big computer screen. Everything can be controlled there because the doors are open. That's what you're seeing right now is where the door is. In fact, if I close the door, you can actually watch it close on that screen. The screen even has the same paint as my car does, which is kind of wild. This has the autopilot, and I actually used the autopilot to drive home from the factory. We got the factory tour yesterday in Fremont.
Now,
it is amazing.
I can't wait to hear about the factory tour, but did you take a nap while you were on the
autopilot? No, I'm not crazy.
Okay.
I think
well,
you'd have to be...
I don't know about that.
You'd have to be nuts to let the car drive, but... I did on the highway turn on autopilot. I changed lanes. It did that effectively. It was able to follow the car ahead of me, slow down when the cars slow down. You could set how many lengths it's going to go from 1 second stopping distance to 7 seconds stopping distance. And the Tesla representative said, turn it high when you first start it so you won't feel anxious about being too close to the cars in front of you. I got it partly because of the Falcon Wing doors, but also because we have solar panels. I love the idea of being able to drive without putting a burden on the environment. And it's also really a fun car. So what we're going to do is I'm going to drive it for a while. Lisa will drive it. Maybe you'll drive it. We'll let people try it. And then we'll do a review in the next couple of weeks of how well it goes. But I have to say my initial experiences after only a day, it is the most fun car I've ever driven. It has the most high-tech features. It's very effective. I think Elon has figured out a way to make something really exciting. It's a luxury car. Starts at $70,000. This version is $130,000. But that's also part of his master plan, is to bootstrap the production of more affordable vehicles by selling luxury cars in the luxury car market. I think he's done a good job.
So we should take a look at your bumper sticker, too.
Well, that's I'm making a statement here. Not only does it say zero emissions and all-wheel drive on the back, but it also tells you that this car is powered by, wait for it, free BSD. That's actually a lie. It is not powered by free BSD, but I wish it were.
But it's not powered by gas.
It's not powered by gas.
So how was the factory tour?
Oh my gosh, the factory tour, I was in tears. I was in tears. It's so exciting to see. I mean, there are humans, and by the way, they seem like they're happy. They're enjoying themselves. Remember, we spent some time on the assembly line at the Ford plant in Dearborn, the Rouge plant, watching them make F-150 trucks. This is much more automated than that. Robots handle a lot of the moving parts around, the arc welding, the assembly. The factory, though, is somewhat like the Rouge plant, like Henry Ford's dream, because aluminum ingots come in the front door, plastic beads come in the front door. Much of the car is actually manufactured in that plant, that massive NUMMI plant that was built originally by General Motors and Toyota many years ago.
Wow.
And is now actually built by General Motors, eventually run by General Motors and Toyota, but now run by Tesla. Has a lot more capacity. They're already doing the construction for the Model 3 capacity. So a lot of fun. Should I open the door one more time? Why don't I open both gullwing doors?
Oh, watch out. Is there someone coming?
Who cares?
Would
it doesn't
open
matter. They better
if
get
someone
out of the
was
way.
Coming?
Yeah, it has sensors all over. In theory, it's not gonna open unless
in theory
somebody's coming. What it mostly does is stop traffic when you do that. Where we're going, we don't need any oil, Marty. The Model X. All right, we're going to take a break. Fredrick Van Johnson is here. I love doing this with photographers. We asked him, Fredrick, what's in your bag?
Hey, guys, I'm Fredrick Van Johnson from thisweekinphoto.com. I get asked a lot about what's in my camera bag. I keep a lot of little tiny things in my camera bag just in case. One of the really important things is stability, and that's this thing right here. This is a tripod from Joby. It's a GorillaPod magnetic. It's awesome. This little thing has magnetic feet. Each one of those little red feet are magnetic. I can clamp things to the top of it. I can put my camera on here. I can put a tripod. I can put a cell phone on here, whatever I want, and attach it to pretty much anything. It weighs almost nothing, 20-something ounces. It's good to go. Check it out. It's the Joby GorillaPod Magnetic. My name is Fredrick Van Johnson from thisweekinphoto.com.
So I thought it might be kind of fun to show you, is the software. So you get there's an Android app or an iOS app. The car, by the way, small thing, but it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 USB ports. Two in the front, two in the middle row, one in the back. So everybody gets a charger.
And that is not a small thing. If you have three children, you know
that
is not a small thing. Everybody
over the
needs
charger.
Their own charger. Yeah.
So I'm gonna. It's gonna. It takes a little time. The Android app is a little bit slower, I'm told, than the. Let me relaunch it here. Than the iPhone app in getting the vehicle. The vehicle's, by the way, always online. So one of the first things you do when you get home is you pair it to your home Wi-Fi, but it always has an LTE connection, and it uses that all the time. It uses that for audio, for music, and for streaming. They have TuneIn and Slacker accounts and so forth, but it also uses it to connect to this app. So I can tell, even when I'm not in the car, how much electricity is left. So you see 233 miles are left. I could see what I could turn on if I want the climate control. So if it's hot outside as it is today, I can see what temperature the car is, and I can cool it off. Let's see. I can also do things like honk the horn, flash the lights. Did you hear that?
I heard.
Yeah. I can unlock the car remotely. But my favorite part is this. It always knows where the car is. And you can actually see it when somebody else is driving the car. You could see the map, just like a Google map, of the car driving down the street. So you could tell where your car is at all times, even if somebody steals it. I guess if they turned off the LTE, you wouldn't know.
Or if you turned it on autopilot and saw it.
Now, there is something called Summon, which I haven't had the nerve to do. You can use this app and say, car, come to me, and it will open the garage door, back out, and open its doors and say, get in. I haven't had the nerve to try that yet. So maybe we'll save that for later.
Does it really say get in?
No, but
it's not.
But
the
message is pretty clear when the door is open. It's a little kind of Stephen King-y, right?
Mm-hmm. It is.
It's mailbox time! Here comes the magic mailbox. I don't know, it rolls all by itself. Wait a minute. Did you go see the new movie?
Okay. I have a confession to make. I haven't seen number two yet, so tonight we're watching number two, and then tomorrow we're going to go see number three.
This is the next generation board game.
Yeah, interactive VCR board game.
Well, you know, this is appropriate because this week, the very last VCR was made in Japan.
In Japan, I know. It's
no
sad.
More VCRs.
No more. We can't be kind and rewind anymore.
So where did you get this? Is this yours, Tanya? All right. Well, let's find a VCR. We could play Star Trek: The Next Generation VCR board game, a Klingon challenge.
There are Enterprise crew members on board. Klingon Koldashatan will not matter. I control life support, navigation, and weapon systems on this ship.
Oh, I know who this is. I know whose this is. It's Alex. It's not Alex's.
I have one.
It's Anthony's.
Anthony, you have this?
Both Alex and I have that.
I got it when I was 9
years old. How did you like the movies? I know most of the Twit crew went on Thursday night.
It was good.
It's good, huh? It's kind of an action movie, right?
We know it's not the old Star Trek.
It's not the old Star Trek. It's a lot of fist fighting, I hear.
Better than the last two.
All right. Would you like to answer a question from the mailbag?
I would love to answer a question from the mailbag.
There you go. I'll give you one, and I'll take one. And wait a minute. Let's mail this interactive VCR game back.
Back to 1989.
Back to 1989. Bye-bye.
All right. It doesn't say who asked this question, sadly.
It's a mystery.
It's a mystery, but whoever asked it, thanks for writing in. Are there any good options for VR on an iOS device? Now.
Apparently, it's from Gonzo.
Oh, Gonzo. Oh, I thought that was the answer to the question. Thanks. 42. I don't know.
You know what? The answer is no.
Well, you know.
You could do cardboard, right?
Well, I have this ViewMaster, which we've all reviewed.
That's cool.
It's an okay option for $30.
You put your
phone in there. It's even augmented reality, sort of.
So the answer is yes. I shouldn't say no. But the reason I said no is because typically, you want a phone that has higher resolution than even the iPhone 6S, which is 1080p. Most of the phones, the Android phones you use for these, are 1440.
I put it in backwards.
And the reason is you're splitting the screen up in half. So you want a lot of resolution for VR.
Yeah.
But Google makes a cardboard app for the iPhone. So if you have the Google Cardboard, which is inexpensive, you can do that. And the ViewMaster is kind of cardboard plus because it has that cardboard thing, but it also has an augmented reality part to it. So, but you're not going to get...
You didn't see that?
No, we saw it.
You couldn't see what I could see.
You just don't want to see it again.
Okay. Ever.
No.
But there are a lot of apps, too. Now, Google just released the Google Arts and Culture app, which is cardboard ready. So if you have a device like that, or if you have cardboard, you can look in all of the hundreds of museums and go on tours. It's very cool. I mean, it's more 360 degree video than it is VR. You know, some people get very upset when you call 360 degree video VR. It's not.
Yeah, it's immersive video.
But you know, it is great for education.
I think so too. Do your kids? Well, they love the Oculus.
Yeah, they asked again today. Can we come in today? Yeah. Can we come in every day? They would like to play with the Vive.
Is the Vive working? Yeah. Okay.
If it's not, they didn't break it.
I didn't do it. Who did it? Nobody. That nobody gets in so much trouble.
Yes.
Hi, Megan and Leo. This is from Ryan. Love your show. Just finished 290, the one we did on spring cleaning your iOS device. He's a few seasons behind, but that's okay. Do you recommend anything to export your iMessages to free up space? The normal Google search came up with iExplore, but I was wondering if someone has used it. I have about 1.6 gigabytes in messages I'd like to clear off. Yeah, the one I like is from Ecamm, E-C-A-M-M. It's called Phone Viewer. It allows you have to hook it up via USB cable to, I think it's Mac. It may have a Windows. I think it does have a Windows. $30, and it'll let you copy not just messages, but a lot of the content that's on your phone. It's a great way to save it. Of course, backing up will also do it.
Yeah, doesn't backup do that?
But backup doesn't make it accessible unless you restore.
Got
right?
it.
I mean, I guess you could dig around in the backup file, but probably not the best idea. So if you want to pull the messages off and just have a backup of them, absolutely use iTunes Backup. But if you want to be able to read them later, I think it's a good idea. There it is. That's a PDF now.
So if you just want to transfer them to a new phone, use backup.
Yeah.
But iBackupBot was another one that I looked at that was free that seemed also good. I downloaded it and I saw my messages. It's not, you know, it's not the most beautiful interface, but I could read them.
There you go, iBackupBot. I really like PhoneView for more than just messages, and that's the one I've used and recommend. But the whole idea is this stuff is on the drive in the phone, and Apple actually doesn't really do much to protect it. You can pull it off pretty easily.
Mm-hmm.
And then just either erase your phone or just, what do you go to the usage section and you delete the messages.
Mm-hmm.
That will save. Gosh, what do you have? 1.6 gigabytes? That's a significant amount.
That is.
You're going to get the iPhone 7? You excited about that?
I am pretty excited about the iPhone 7. I mean, my iPhone is...
I'm so sick of using headphones. I'm really looking forward to not having that option ever again.
I don't really use the jack very often.
You don't?
No, I don't.
You don't walk around with the phone speaker open so that everybody can hear what you're
listening to. I have Bluetooth headphones.
Ah, okay.
And I don't talk on the phone very often anyway,
right.
And not when I'm usually walking around.
Yeah.
There are very few instances that I actually use the headphone jack. I have an auxiliary cable in one of my cars, but, you know, I'm going to get the Tesla anyway, so,
right? Yeah.
I mean.
And that pairs, and then you don't need anything. You're set?
Yeah, set.
It's gold.
So.
It doesn't, you know, it's weird because you'd think the Tesla would support either Android Auto or CarPlay.
It doesn't.
Apple's CarPlay, no.
It has its own thing.
That big screen, it has its own thing. It just does its own thing. Huh. You know what it does do that's kind of weird? It will pull from the iPhone, if you have the Tesla app on the iPhone, it will pull from the iPhone calendar. I can have a calendar display on that big screen of what's coming, my appointments. I don't know how useful that is. It's a little strange. Wow. I just wish we could do more shows together, you and I.
Maybe let's do one together on Monday.
Should we do it tomorrow or Monday? Yeah.
Monday, yeah.
What do you think we should talk about
on Monday? I don't know. Maybe the iPhone, the Apple Watch, the Apple TV, the iPad?
Sounds good to me. Sounds good to me.
Yeah, we're going to talk about summer movie tie-in apps. So if you have suggestions, send them to Megan at twit.tv. I've got a couple. But if you have a favorite summer movie tie-in app.
Does it have to be this summer?
Yeah.
Could I play the Frozen app?
Yeah. I know how much you love the Frozen app.
And the Nemo
You'll
app.
Never let that go.
Gotta love that. Megan Morrone hosts not only iOS Today every Monday, a lot of fun, we wear funny hats, but also TNT Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, 2300 UTC. Thank you,
Sometimes
Megan.
It's 2100 UTC, I think. Maybe not. It's different. It changes when we change.
Does it? Yeah, we change, but
it never changes.
We're plus 7. So you add 7 to 12 is 19, plus 4 is 23.
Okay, 23. It's 42. The answer is 42.
I'm just making this stuff up. You know that. I have no idea what time it is. I don't know what time it is right now. I know it's time to say goodbye, sad to say.
Probably.
If you want to watch the show live, we do it Saturday afternoons around about 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern, 2200 UTC. If you can't watch live, you can always watch after the fact because we have on-demand audio and video, not just of this show, but all of our shows on our website, twit.tv/NSS. Don't forget, we've got a great newsletter. If you want to know what's coming up or some of the best highlights from the week gone by, that's free. No salesman will call. Just go to twit.tv/newsletter and subscribe. You get the newsletter. Jerry does a great job putting that together. I've been meaning to write for it every week, and I just got to force myself to do that because I have so much to say. And it would be fun to have one more place
right,
to say.
Right, yeah, you don't really have a voice.
Just don't have a voice.
No.
No. Let's see, what else? I think that's everything. Thanks for
that's
joining. If you want to be in the studio, we got a great studio audience. All you have to do is email tickets at twit.tv so we can put a chair out for you. And I should explain that we're about to move the studio. So we think it's going to be, I think we're still on track for moving it on Sunday, August 21st. So new screensavers the day before, we will not have a live audience because this place is going to be empty. We're going to have moved everything out. And what we're going to do is I'm going to go to the new studio and do the new screensavers just by myself in that room, that echoey room over there. And then we'll do this tech guy from here, one last show on the 21st. We have a cable car, which is amazing because there's no tracks in Petaluma, so it's going to be an interesting ride. We have a cable car. Everybody's going to get in, and we're going to bring everything. I'm going to bring the clock, and we're going to get in. We're going to drive over to the new studio, and our first show from the new studio will be August 21st, Twit, at 3 p.m. So that if that all works out. And then the new screensavers will be in the new studio from that point on. So just a note, if you're going to come to the show, don't come to this building because it'll be a brewery. And while you may have more fun, you won't find any shows, right?
Maybe you might find some shows, but not
some
tech shows.
Not our show. Yeah, I don't know what's going to go on here. Actually, it's going to be an empty shell for a little while anyway. So there you go. Tickets at twit.tv. Thanks for being here. Well, I hope you had a good time. We sure did. We'll see you next time on the new Screensavers. Bye-bye. And there are...